Hello and welcome everyone to this talk sponsored by the Society for Libyan Studies. I'm Dr. Mona Abdelhamed. Today I'd like to talk about some important, reliable and accessible resources on the Libyan heritage. I'm going to tell you about these digital projects because they include primary data and can be accessed online by everyone. Therefore, I do invite all of you, especially those in Libya, students, lecturers, and researchers, to visit them and benefit from the available data. Let us go. Before I start talking about these digital resources, let me tell you about digitizing the Libyan heritage, who established these digital websites, and about their sources of information. As you know, modern digital technologies in the world are now witnessing rapid development, and researchers have benefited from this in all fields of human knowledge. The same approach has been taken by historians and archaeologists, especially those interested in the history and archaeology of Libya in the Greek and Roman periods. So they used these tools to provide data and information in various materials relevant to the Libyan heritage. So now different kinds of materials have become available and accessible to everyone via the internet. As my talk develops, you will see that the Greek and Roman inscriptions will have won the lion's share of these projects. These inscriptions have been published under the wider international project named Inscriptions of Libya. However, I must begin with by asking the question, as it needs to be answered, who have established these websites and are continually working to improve them? To answer this question, I should say that researchers from different academic institutions in various countries, such as France, Britain, and Italy, in addition to those from Libya, have participated together in this work. Those who take part in these projects are from various academic institutions, such as the 4th Sorbonne University in Paris, the Universities of Bologna, Macerata, and Pisa in Italy, King's College in London, University of Cambridge, University of Benghazi in Libya, and others. These projects are received moral and documentary support from many institutions, such as the Departments of Antiquities in Libya, especially those of Tripoli, Shahat, Susa, Dilmeita, Tokra, Benghazi, Lobda, and Sabrata. The projects also received support from the Libyan Studies, François Chamou Archive in Paris, the Louvre Museum, the British Museum, and many other official and unofficial individual contributors. Regarding the project's sources of information, the information collected from the European traveler accounts, also from the publications of the foreign archaeological missions and other individual researchers. The material of these websites consists of the personal observations and reports of the European travelers and the work of the researchers who already had started visiting Libya in the 18th century AD, such as the French consul in Tripoli, Claudio Limer, the French surgeon Granier, also the works of Paolo della Cella, Basho, the brothers Bisci, William Warrington, and others. Further information was also gained from the available publications of the foreign archaeological missions, in addition to the individual researchers. These are varied. I'm going to list some of them here. Let us start with the result of the excavation mission led by the brothers Smith and Borchardt. The publication of the American Richard Norton, African Italiana, the publication of Silvio Ferri. Also, Oliverio publication in 1936, Joyce Reynolds' publication alongside other information she was gathered and published in these websites for the first time. The book of Reynolds and Perkins on the inscriptions of Roman Tripolitania, which was published in 1952. volumes number 9 and 19 from SEG. Godchild's publication alone or with Reynolds for many Greek and Latin inscriptions. Articles published in Libya Antiqua of Tripoli, which started in 1964. The works of the Italian mission at Cyrene, the French mission at Apollonia, the Polish mission at Tilmeitha. We should also not forget the series of quaderni, the Africa Romana and Libyan Studies. Catherine Dupias Lalo publications on Libyan inscriptions was also another significant source of information. So the first group of the digital resources include four websites, and these are inscriptions of Roman Tripolitania, inscriptions of Greek Cyrenaica and the Greek verse inscriptions of Cyrenaica, inscriptions of Roman Cyrenaica, and Ostraca from Bungay. Regarding the inscriptions of Roman Tripolitania, the work in this project was supervised by Professor Charlotte Rocher, Hafez El Walda, Gabriel Boudrad, and other researchers. This website contains inscriptions from Roman Tripolitania. These inscriptions were previously published in a book by Reynolds and Ward Perkins in 1952. Then in 2009, it was published in an electronic version and has become available to everyone since then online. The electronic version is characterized by the increase of image of all inscriptions, along with geographical data linking to the inscriptions with maps, dictionaries, references, etc. In addition to the English translation of the Latin text, which were provided by Reynolds herself. this is the main web page of the project. I have added here a photo for Reynolds and another for her book with Perkins. Let us search on an inscription here, 23 for example, what we will find. As we can see, there are different information about the inscription 23, what it is about, description, the date, the original text, the English translation, a photo, and even a bibliography. The second digital resource is inscriptions of Greek Cyrenaica and Greek verse inscriptions of Cyrenaica. Professor Catherine Dubias-Lalu has led this work with contribution by many researchers, including Joyce Reynolds herself. The materials published in two online epidoc corpora. The first includes all Greek Cyrenaican inscriptions from the 7th to the 1st century BC, and the second contains Greek poetic texts from all Greek and Roman period. This covers the period from the 6th century BC to the 6th century AD. This electronic version has become available since 2017. To the first collection, inscriptions of Greek Cyrenaica, it includes about 917 texts from Greek Cyrenaica. Most of these inscriptions were previously published in various versions, but about 122 of them haven't been published yet. The second collection, which is called Greek Verse Inscriptions of Cyrenaica, contains about 56 poetic texts from Greek and Roman Cyrenaica. 48 of them have been published so far. Of course, most of these texts were reread by Professor Catherine Dubias-Lalu, who had been a member of the French archaeological mission to Libya since 1976. She was able to examine most of these materials available in Shahat, Susa, and she made shorter visits to Ptolemais, Tokra, Benghazi, and other places. What makes this digital resource differ from the others is translating the Greek inscriptions into four languages, as we can see in the web page: English, French, Italian, and Arabic. Actually, the Arabic translation hasn't finished yet. I'm still working on this part, a bit slow, but we'll continue. So if we click on AR at the top right of the page, we will see the Arabic version of the web page. And this demonstrates the translated parts into Arabic. Let us have a look to this example. It is a Demirjoy inscription. We can see the general needed information with bibliography, the Greek text, a photo, and a map for the location of the inscription, as we can see in the top right. This is the rest of the page on the Demirjoy inscription. It shows the different translations of the original text: the French, the English, the Italian, and the Arabic. It also shows some comments on the Greek text. The third digital resource is inscriptions of Roman Cyrenaica. This project is still being supervised by Professor Charlotte Roche with the assistance of other researchers. The website will hopefully be available and accessible soon. Preparation for this website project started at the beginning of 2018. It contains approximately 2,300 inscriptions, all of which were collected by Joyce Reynolds from Cyrenaica. Nearly half of them haven't been published yet. The published inscriptions were carefully reread and translated into English. Also 3,000 photos were added to the website, some of them provided by Joyce Reynolds herself, with additional photos provided by the Libyan Department of Antiquities. Some were taken by Catherine Dubias Lalo, Dorothy Thorne, and Hafid Al-Walda, while others came from different archaeological missions, including those that were taken by Norton in 1910. This page shows an example of the inscription of this project. It tells us about the general information we need about this text. The fourth and the last digital website on the inscriptions of Libya is Ostraca of Bunjame. The website contains 146 documents dating back to the middle of the 3rd century AD, and in particular to 253-259. These documents contain information about the Roman army in North Africa during that period, including messages, daily reports, and lists of people's name. The Ostraca were found in a military site in Bunjame on the outskirts of the empire in North Africa. They reflect a communication between the soldiers and the local population. These records contain many African words and names, some of which were not previously known. The soldiers themselves often have African names. They may have been recruited locally, but were not fluent in Latin. So the Latin they wrote raises some questions. We could see information about any inscription via the project's web page by clicking on any of them. This web page shows one of the inscriptions of Bunjame. It shows different information with the Latin text and its English translation. The value of this text lies in its confirmation of the use of the camels in Libya by the Roman army. In the second part of my talk, I'm going to speak about another two projects: the Heritage Gazetteer of Libya and the Archives of the Society for Libyan Studies and a Society for Libyan Studies Photo Library. The first website is Heritage Gazetteer of Libya and the Archive of the Society for Libyan Studies, and this is the main web page. We could search under Gazetteer here, where the highlighted with the yellow, or search on under the search archive. Regarding the Heritage Gazetteer, it is a gazetteer of heritage sites and monuments in Libya, recording and searchable by all known names for a given location. The basic work on the gazetteer was undertaken by Dr. Hafid Al-Walda. Then the data were transformed to provide a web resource by Neil Jackman. The work on this project began in 2007 and has become available online since March 2016. It has been supervised by members of the Society for Libyan Studies, along with other researcher from King's College. The project was and still is led by Professor Charlotte Roche, who is working with Dr. Hafid Al-Walda, Dr. Gabriel Boudrad, and others. The data for this website has been added from the Ancient World Gazetteer videos which draw largely on material gathered by Professor David Mattingly and from the guidebooks on Tripolitania and Cyrenaica by Philip Kenrick and their associated geodata. However, the spelling of Arabic names and their translation into modern European languages is a bit problematic because it produces very variable results. The same name may be expressed differently over time and by European from different language traditions. Some Arabic letters can be translated to more than one European letter. The Arabic letter Qaf of the sound Qaf, for example, can be represented by K, C, or Q, or even G. Its pronunciation in the local Arabic dialects also differs from the pure Arabic. Furthermore, there are no equivalent sounds in the European languages for some of the Arabic letters, such as Da, Dad, Ba. The letter Da is usually translated to the letter T, but the pronunciation of the two letters is completely different. Another problem is writing the right Arabic name for the archaeological site, and the name also had to have existed by 1950. If we search on the name cert, for example, in the Gazetteer, as can we see in this web page, there are two Arabic names of cert. The name Sha'biyat Sirt, the first one labeled with the question mark, should not be added here for two reasons. The first is that the name Sha'biyat Sirt represents the city Sirt itself and other cities around, like Hrawa, Raslanov, etc. The second reason is that the name was given after 1969 and the Gazetteer is recording names given prior to 1950. There is therefore a great need for Libyans, especially those who understand European languages, to contribute their understanding and their local knowledge. I'm going to show you the society webpage at the end of this talk. So, colleagues and members of the society with more information, especially those in Libya, could request the society for access. Regarding the archives of the Society for Libyan Studies, I must also mention that the archives of the Society for Libyan Studies is included in this website. It includes maps, photographs of different archaeological sites from Libya. The archive is now hosted in the School of Archaeology and Ancient History at Leicester University, and now the society is launching a project to register and digitize these materials to be accessible for those interested in the history and archaeology of Libya. The second digital resource is Society for Libyan Studies Photo Library. The photo library project is one of the Society for Libyan Studies ways of collaboration to record the heritage of Libya. The society is now following the example of the National Archives to set up photographic library in Flickr. This is the main web page, which has newly established in this year, so we can see a modest number of photos. Hopefully, we will see more soon from the society's members. The goal of this project is to record and display photos of heritage sites in Libya, current and historical. Therefore, members of the society are invited to contribute. All photos published here are available for free to reuse, but of course with attribution. just to let you know that each image will be uploaded here, will be attributed to the contributor. To the society members who wish to contribute, you could see the instructions of the web page or on the web page or contact the society itself. Let us see an example here of a photo. It represents the port of Tripoli in 1939. This was added by a member of the society with comment. What is important here is to provide accurate and plentiful information about the photo. Also, to the location, it would be more useful to use the Heritage Gazetteer of Libya with attribution, as can be seen in this provided example here. So, if you click on the link of the Gazetteer, it will show you the port location on a map. Before ending this talk, let me show you the web page of the Society for Libyan Studies. We have at the top right, at the top left, the contact details. Also, from this web page, you could get more information about the society and its different activities relating to the Libyan culture and heritage. Interestingly, you also could view the society publications, those for sale or that are free to download, such as the case of the publications in Arabic. As we have seen, there are a variety of significant reliable resources on the Libyan heritage. These are interestingly available and accessible via the internet. So colleagues, especially in Libya, could easily use them. For more information about these websites, you could see the paper published by Charles Touroche and I in Libyan Studies in 2019. This titled Digitizing Libyan Heritage Inscriptions and Toponymy. And another paper published in the same year in Quaderni by Catherine Tobias Lalo and Alice Pinsilvini about the project of inscriptions of Greek Cyrenaica. Finally, as these resources are developing every day, let me recommend some points I wish to be considered. The first one is adding the sources of names given to the archaeological sites recorded in the Heritage Gazetteer of Libya. The second one is translating the Greek and Latin inscriptions into Arabic. The third one is adding the inscriptions which were published in Arabic language by the Libyan scholars. The last one, establishing similar websites on the Libyan heritage of prehistoric and Islamic periods. Thank you very much.